Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this webinar. My name is Joanne from Workflow Dynamics Europe team. As you will have seen for this series, we are pleased to welcome some of our users from across the world to share their T-Navigator projects with you. Today, you will hear from Laurent Pilardini, Senior Reservoir Engineer at Vermilion Energy. Laurent is joining us today from France to present to you thermal modelling used for a heat co-production project. If you haven't joined one of our webinars before, just to let you know that all of the attendees have been automatically muted. So if you'd like to ask a question, please use the window in the control panel and we'll answer as many of those as we can at the end. If there's not time to address your question live, we'll arrange a follow-up. We have permission from Vermilion to record the session, so that will be uploaded to our YouTube channel later today. And if you've got any further questions, don't hesitate to reach out to us on asktnav@rfdyn.com. So for now, I would like to hand over to Laurent, and I'll be back for the questions at the end of the session. Thank you very much. Well, I will just change that over to you.
Hello. Hello, everyone. So my name is Laurent Ghilardini. I'm a reservoir engineer working for Vermilion Energy in the southwest of France. And today I'm going to share with you the thermal modeling using T-Navigator for a heat co-production project in the Aquitaine Basin. So first, a few words about Vermilion Energy. Vermilion Energy is an international energy producer that seeks to create value through the acquisition of exploration, development, and optimization of producing properties in North America, Europe, and Australia. Vermilion is targeting production of between 94,000 to 98,000 barrels oil equivalent per day this year. And today I am working in for the Southwest department, if you wish, or assets near Bordeaux. And I'm going to present you this project located in the Southwest of Bordeaux. The framework of the project, Vermilion Energy is strongly involved in sustainable developments, especially in the Aquitaine Basin. We have several projects that have already taken place, like the heat co-production for 10 hectares greenhouse called Tom Daki, in parentheses, since 2008. So we use produced water to provide some heat to this greenhouse. And also there is heat co-production for the Eco Quarter of La Teste de Buch. Today's project is about heat co-production of a high school. The project is financed by a European consortium called MEET-EGS for multidisciplinary and multi-context demonstration of enhanced geothermal systems, exploration and exploitation techniques and potentials. This consortium aims at boosting the development of enhanced geothermal systems across Europe. The description of the project now. There are two fields involved. The first one is called Les Pins, where you can see the surface facilities in the north of the map here. Later, I will call it LPS. And the other field is Les Arbousiers, that I will call LEA, in the south part here, where you have two facility systems, if you want. And here you can see the Eco Quarter that is already provided with heat. So in fact, what you have is the liquid is going through this pipe in red, is gathering also the liquid from LEA and is going to Les Arbousiers Center, where it is the liquid is separated between oil and water. And then the water is going this way and it is partially reinjected in Les Arbousiers, LEA, and then The rest is injected in Les Pins. So the heat exchange we want to realize will be here to provide some heat to the high school from the water going to be re-injected here. So the heat exchanger is going to be here. And the current project consists in evaluating the viability of providing heat to this high school. What we know from the technical subsurface point of view is that LEA LPS reservoirs are at about 100 degrees Celsius. There are heat losses in the water between the producers downhole to the injectors at the surface because there is a long pass in the colder environment. The re-injected water downhole at injectors is at about 70 degrees Celsius, so it's colder than the produced water. There is another thing is that sometimes we complete the injection with source water coming from shallow reservoirs. And this water with low salinity is at around 30 degrees Celsius downhole at injectors. So much colder than the produced water. So what we want to know is if this colder water injected had or will have an impact on the temperature evolution at producers downhole. And at the end, at the high school heat exchanger. That's why we wanted to model the cold temperature wave in the reservoir to know if one day we are going to produce a colder water and if this will be a problem to deliver the heat to the high school. Today, I will focus on only one field. We have made the model for two fields, but I'm going to present you only Les Pins, LPS. Note that we are not used to do this kind of thermal modeling in Vermilion, so we are still learning. The LPS field overview, here you have the top map. What you can see is in the south, you have LPS 2D, which is the injector, current injector. Here you have LPS 1D, which is the closest well, and it is at 580 meters from the injection. And then you have the two farthest wells, LPS 3D and PLS 5D, which are also producing. It's a good permeability, good porosity sandstone reservoir. You have the history of production and injection, production in green of oil, in green of water in blue. And the blue line is injection. As you can see, the injection has started around 1 year after production. This is the well's oil production contribution. Let's talk briefly about the aquifer. Here you can see the evolution of pressure in the field through times. As you can see, and here below, you have the voidage replacement ratio. As you can see, each time that we are not injecting much, like at the beginning or here where we're almost not injecting, the pressure is decreasing a lot. So it's strongly, the reservoir is strongly depending on injection, and we have quite a weak aquifer in the system. And so we expect some produced water to come partially from the re-injected water. Now we have some data about salinity of the water at the producers. In blue, you have the salinity of LPS 1D, the well that is the closest to the injection. And here you have LPS 3D in orange, and in yellow, it's 5D, but it has produced later. What you can see, and this line in dashed blue is the proportion of source water. So with low salinity, as you can see at the beginning, we were massively injecting source water, almost only source water. And you can see the drop of salinity for the producers more or less at the same time, around less than 1 year after injection. So this means that the injected water has traveled from injector to producers in less than 1 year, even for the farthest wells. And after the decrease, the proportion of decrease depends on the distance. the closest well is declining faster than the farthest well. Let's talk about the classical history matched model. It has been built using T-Navigator. In order to match the model classically, several parameters have been tuned, like the baffles between layers, the permeability multipliers in layers. It has been multiplied depending on the layer from 3 to 5. We have added a south numerical aquifer, and then some adjustments on the PI have been done based on PLT observations. I show you directly the result at the field level of the history match. In liquid rate, it was matched in liquid rate. So you can see the oil rate match, the water cut match, which is pretty good, and the total cumulatives for the field. So it was a good history match. It was fit for purpose. I don't spend so much time on that. And now we will focus on the temperature and thermal things. Just before, yeah, I wanted to show you, we have put in T-Navigator the tracers, virtual tracers, if you want, in the injectors to see the proportion of injected water that was produced. So in blue here for LPS1D, you have the total water production, and in light blue, the production coming from the injected water. So the proportion is quite high. It's reaching about 80% at the end. And you can see that the breakthrough is quick, almost at the beginning. And even for the farthest well, the orange here is the injected water produced, and in blue is the total water produced. You can see that the injected water comes very quickly to this producer as well, which is compatible with what we have seen with the salinity data. So now let's talk about the thermal modeling. What we have used in T-Navigator is a temperature option. For the temperature option, you have several keywords, mandatory, optional. With arrow, I show you which keywords we have used in this specific model. The first one is temp R, so it indicates the temperature option is enabled. And when you have the R, it means as well that you are taking into account the zero pore volume cells. You consider that even if they have zero pore volume, they can participate to the heat calculation and to the heat capacity. After, you have to define the specific volume of the rock, specific volume of oil, gas, and water, oil viscosity versus temperature, water viscosity versus temperature, viscosity reference pressure, then the rock thermal conductivity. Then you have to initialize the temperature in the reservoir. We have chosen to define a temperature versus depth. You have to also specify the temperature of injected water with W temp. And what we have defined as well, it was optional, but we have defined like boundary conditions to define the properties of the material surrounding the reservoir. Now, when you want to make the model, you have to define all that. When you work on conventional oil fields, you don't have most of the time a lot of data, but I will describe what we have done. So first, the W temp, so the temperature of injected water. What we have done is it has been built from the known proportion of source versus produced water injected monthly, taking into account the data from PLT showing that the produced water had a temperature of 70 degrees downhole, and the source water 30 degrees downhole. So it was just a proportion of these two temperatures depending on the proportion of volume injected. What is interesting to see is that historically, the average temperature of water injected, due to the fact that we were also injecting source water, the average temperature was 44 degrees Celsius from 1995 to today, which is quite cold compared to the 100 degrees Celsius of the reservoir. Regarding the temperature of produced liquid downhole, something we would like to match in a way, we didn't have so many data. Just for LPS5, LPS3, we were able to monitor the temperature thanks to ESP gauges. But it was after 2011 and only for these two wells. We don't have data for LPS1, which is the closest well from the injection. But this data for the farthest wells is showing that the temperature has not changed in the years 2011, even 2019. So we expect the temperature, the cold wave, not to reach this well, at least today. The initial reservoir temperature, we have gathered all the available initial data from available gauges, from MDT, RFT, static gradient surveys, and so on, in order to get this gradient that you see here, and to implement that in the reservoir to initialize the temperature versus depth in T-Navigator. Now, the rest of the properties you have to define, oil viscosity, water viscosity versus temperature. Generally, we don't have this kind of data, so we have used most of the time correlations. Sometimes values from the literature, like the volume specific heat of rock, thermal conductivity, we have taken from the literature equivalent from similar reservoirs and similar depths. For the boundary conditions, we have assumed that we would keep the same properties laterally, and we would define a lower conductive material, shale, above and below. So the result here, you have described the base case history model, defining the initial temperature gradient, the properties of the rocks, the boundary conditions, the options. What you can see in the mid layer here of the reservoir, and we are today, is that the cold wave has only reached LPS 1D. So the cold wave is between the injector and this well. It has not reached yet these two producers, LPS 3D and 5D. And it's consistent with the only data we have, that is the ESP data showing that the temperature has not changed in 3D and 5D. Now for the forecast, what we have included is the fact that we are going to convert LPS 1D, which is producing a lot of water, into a water injector. It's in order to increase the capacity of injection, and then also, as we are re-injected the produced water, being able to produce more liquid and more oil. So to optimize the production of these two wells that are quite good, LPS 5D and 3D. So we have integrated that in the forecast. We have also integrated the fact that we are going to provide some heat to the high school. So we have decreased the temperature of the injected water. We are not injecting any more source water, but instead of 70 degrees, we are going to inject at 63 degrees Celsius due to the high school project. Now you can see the results of the downhole temperature at the producers or injectors. Here you can see LPS 1D. This is the temperature of the liquid produced. You can see that because this well was closer to the injector, and at that time we were injecting a lot of source water, the temperature had decreased by 13 degrees, something like that. Now we are converting this well to injection. So here you can see the injected water temperature. Now LPS 3D, you can see that the temperature had not changed in the past, but what we can expect because now LPS1D is also an injector and discloser to LPS3D, we can expect in 2040 a decrease compared to today of 10 degrees Celsius. More or less the same thing for LPS5D. What we wanted to do, because we are not sure about all these parameters that are coming from correlations or literature, or even for the injection rate, there are some uncertainties. We wanted to see what was the impact of each parameter on the result. So here the result is a LPS5D final temperature in 2040. And you can see the variation of each parameter in the result. What we can see, so we are quite far from the injector, but several things impact negatively the final temperature, like the water injection temperature, thermal conductivity of the rock, bottom rock conductivity, specific heat capacity of fluids. But overall, when you look at the value, what impacts negatively, the maximum is minus 1 degree Celsius compared to the base case value. So it's not huge. The uncertainty is quite low. So at the end, it tells you that all these parameters don't matter a lot in the final result within the uncertainty we have on these parameters. Note the positive impact of massively reducing the injection rate. Of course, when you reduce the injection rate, you are going to slow down the water, the cold water travel along the reservoir, and then you are going to increase, if you want, the temperature produced. But this rate of 400 cubic meters per day is unlikely. So it's not going to happen, in fact. Now, the sensitivities in a graph for LPS3D. These are the results of all the sensitivities. You see that the final temperature is not varying along a lot. And this is a disaster case if we have all the negative parameters. Same thing for 5D, it's more or less the same. So now the conclusions. I think I went very fast, but maybe you will have a lot of questions, who knows. The conclusions. First, the thermal models using T-Navigator have been built for Les Arbousiers and Les Pins in order to calculate a forecast of produced water temperature downhole using the keyword temp. These models have limited constraints in terms of thermal parameters. We have sporadic temperature data and only for the farthest wells on LPS, but the sensitivity study allows covering the model uncertainties, and the uncertainty is quite limited on the subsurface point of view. The study shows that the temperature of the produced water downhole could likely decrease by 8 degrees Celsius. Here I integrate also the result from Les Arbousiers that I have not shown here. So 8 degrees Celsius less between today and 2040. This is still below the requirements in terms of heat exchange at the high school. So in a way, we validate the high school project to be viable. On top of that, and this is not shown in this presentation, a surface study has shown that the fact that we convert LPS1D into injection is going to speed up the water travel from injector wellhead to the exchanger. And in fact, this is going to decrease the temperature losses to almost compensate the losses in the reservoir. So it's another good news to validate this project. Now, I will conclude with a few comments on T-Navigator. So T-Navigator is still easy to implement, even in a new option that I didn't know, the temperature option. It's, as usual, user-friendly, intuitive, and the temp option is included in the Black Oil package. So no additional fees. It's always a nice surprise. The possible improvements for T-Navigator, it's for me to be able to integrate like a thermal VLP at wells to convert the downhole temperature to the wellhead temperature at each time step. Today, it's not possible. So if we wanted the temperature at the wellhead at one time step, we were obliged to do it manually, manual calculations. Okay, so that's it. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you to the TNAV team to let me present this this project.
Thank you very much, Laurent, for agreeing to be our first case study speaker on the webinars. I hope everyone really enjoyed the presentation. It was a very interesting project. I have sent you through a few of the questions that have come through. So if you want to have a look, and we do have quite a few, so you can just maybe pick
yes.
like two or three.
Yes.
The timing was perfect, by the way. It wasn't too fast.
Perfect. So I have one question about the salinity, the modeling of the salinity variations across the reservoir. So this is a very good question. This is something I would like to do now, but I was not sure it was possible to do. I didn't think about it at the beginning. I've not done that before. So one of my colleagues talked about that at the end of the project, but it was a bit too late. But yeah, it would be good to do that to validate also the data we have on salinity. Fortunately, now the project is closed, so we don't have any time remaining. But if we have additional time, I will try to do that. So thank you. Yeah. I have a question. What was the biggest challenge for you in this project? It's not obvious in the presentation, but it's to find the data about the proportion of water between source water and produced water. I had to dig into the old reports day by day to find exactly the proportion of source water and produced water. So it was quite boring to do, but it had to be done. And it's about seeking data, looking for data. It's always a pain. Is there any static uncertainty that could potentially be taken into account? Yes, there is always a static uncertainty, but as the history match was not too bad, I don't expect a major uncertainty. Well, that's something we could have done, but it takes quite a lot of time to integrate the static part. The project, the static model was done since a few years, and we didn't want to redo any static work on this model. What parameters did you use for the sensitivity study? Are there more parameters that can be used? I think we have covered most of the uncertain parameters. I've shown the graph. You can come back on it if you wish on the presentation video. I don't see any other parameters that can really matter for the result. Does the water temperature have any impact on oil recovery? That's a good question. So I've done the sensitivity. I've not shown it here. I have used three different correlations because you have to define the change in viscosity depending on temperature. And I have used one correlation, but two others were possible. And I've made the calculation of what is the cumulative oil depending on without the temperature option, with the temperature option, and with the three correlations. And you can have 3 or 4% change in the cumulative oil produced. So that's more or less the change you can have in your recovery, which is not nothing. I mean, it's because when you inject a colder temperature, you can expect your oil to be more viscous and then recover a bit less. So the answer is 3 to 4% less in the simulation. Did you start from zero with TNAV or you had an existing model? If later the case, any comments about scalability, simulation runtime? In fact, I have a very limited period of time to do this project, so a couple of weeks, a few weeks. So we had the static model available, the dynamic model available since 2006. I just updated with the production data and it was matching pretty well. I was lucky. So I just used this simulation model to implement the thermal calculation. The simulation runtime is relatively short, 1 or 2 hours. No parallel performance. It was a relatively small model. Do you think that a strong aquifer candidate will be more efficient for geothermal energy than a weak aquifer based on your experience? So my experience is very limited on the subject. I know that what is more efficient in a classical geothermal energy and what are looking for classical geothermal industries are a big fault allowing to get high temperature from really deep reservoirs. Here we are just taking what we have, and yes, if we had a stronger aquifer, we would have more aquifer water, and then probably warmer water. Yes, but it's not the case. So we are constrained by the location of the fields. We are doing with what we have, and if it was a new project, of course we will not choose a Les Pins if we had to build the project from zero. Okay, that's it for the questions. That's it. Yeah, I think I answered everything.
There are a few more that haven't sent through, but just we're running a bit out of time, so I will send them over to you, Laurent, and maybe you can put together a couple of answers for those that didn't get answered. Okay, thank you so much, Laurent, and thank you as well to Vermilion Energy for allowing you to present the project. And for those of you who would like to join us next week for the webinar, it's on Tuesday the 28th at the same time as today, and that's going to be fault modelling over Carnarvon Petroleum's Buffalo Field with Anthony from Ants Geo Consulting in Perth, Australia. So we hope to see you then. Thank you very much everyone who joined us today, and a big thank you again to Vermilion Energy, and we'll see you all next week. Thank you.
Thank you.